Welcome to this podcast discussing our paper of the Movement Disorder Expertise Center Groningen entitled Diagnostic Approach in Pediatric Movement Disorders, a Clinical Practical Guide. Why do we need a new practical guide? Pediatric movement disorders are a large and heterogeneous group of disorders with a broad spectrum of clinical phenotypes and genotypes. In the recent years, the development of genetics was fast, resulting in a decrease in time to diagnose and costs. In this way, genetic testing becomes an important step in diagnosing patients with movement disorders. However, the most important question remains, who do we test? We therefore developed a clinical diagnostic approach to guide clinicians in where to start. In our approach, two questions play a central role. What do we see and what is the cause? Our clinical approach consists of 8 consecutive steps, starting with the clinical aspect and what do we see in our patient. The first and most important step is to determine if there is a movement disorder. The second step is to classify the movement disorder and determine the most prominent one. You should always consider a functional disorder. And the last step is to determine a clinical syndrome with the additional signs in your patient. The last 4 steps is to answer the question, what is the cause? Consider acquired causes and treatable inborn errors of metabolism. If not, the next step should be genetic testing. Post-NGS phenotyping is the last step to evaluate if the results of genetic testing fits the possible clinical phenotype.
To illustrate our stepwise approach, we will show you an example. This 6-year-old boy came to the outpatient clinic. Especially in young children, it may be difficult to distinguish normal motor patterns from abnormal movement disorders. Here you can see some abnormal posturing, particularly when he's running. The next step is to classify the movement disorder. In our paper, we provide definitions and videos of all main pediatric movement disorders to facilitate recognition in clinical practice. Here you see the same patients 2 years later. As you can see, he developed severe generalized dystonia with a characteristic sensory trick. When he touches his head, the dystonic posturing of the neck improves. Now it's time to define the clinical syndrome. We know now he has dystonia, and we need to look for other movement disorders and also for additional neurological and non-neurological features. This is important because the clinical syndrome is the starting point for diagnostic testing. Our patient did not have any additional features. So in this case, the clinical syndrome is isolated generalized dystonia.
After we determine the clinical syndrome, we would like to know the cause of the dystonia in this child. The first thing to consider is there an acquired cause? And especially medication can induce movement, several kinds of movement disorder in children. The second step is to consider, is there a treatable inborn error of metabolism? They will show up when you do genetic testing, but for some of them, you want to start treatment before the genetic testing is done. In our patient, these 2 forms were not considered. So we went for genetic testing. The first thing to think about is there a specific gene you want to test? For example, in myoclonus dystonia, with this very typical phenotype, you directly sequence the epsilon sarcoglycan gene. But in our patient, there was an isolated generalized dystonia, and then you want to screen for several genes. A step in between is to consider a SNP array, and that's something you especially do when patients also have mental retardation, which was not the case in our patient. So we did a whole exome sequencing. And as a step in between, you can put a filter on top of it and do panel sequencing and specifically look for genes only involved in dystonia. When you do a whole exome sequencing, you have to think about two things. One is you're not screening the mitochondrial DNA and you're not looking for repeat disorders. So if you want to test for those, you have to ask for separate tests. In our patient, we did a whole exome sequencing and we found a DIT16 mutation. And that's important also for the treatment. In our patient, we treated him with deep brain stimulation with a very good effect. And you can see in this next slide that he's now heading for the Paralympics in 2024 and still has his DBS. I would like to thank you for listening to the podcast of our paper. I really hope you find it helpful. When you have a patient with a movement disorder in your clinic, that we will guide you through the diagnostic steps to find the cause of the movement disorder in your patient.